Remember the assignment of last week?
Yes.
All right. Who's done some homework?
Cadmus.
I'm Cadmus and Harmonia. Barbara?
It was.
Huh?
I haven't. I wish I had.
Sarah, anyone?
I have a little bit.
Good. Which one do you have? Which mythology? Which mythology do you have?
Well, I have this book by Robert Graves.
That's the Voluminous, yes.
Okay, yeah.
It's not working for something.
Either the cord that we have doesn't work or something.
Works at home.
Is it one of our extension cords?
No.
Which part is not working? Your monitor?
Yeah.
You got a light at the top there.
That is not. That throws it.
Oh, that throws it off?
Some of the subtle one of you asked Carl to read that. This is for me to tell you.
This is under the Royal House of Thieves.
Europa.
The story of the Stephen family rivals that of the House of Aetius and Thing, and for the same reason, just as the greatest plays of Aeschylus in the 5th century are about Atreus' descendants, so the greatest plays of his contemporary Sophocles are about Oedipus and his children. This is about Cadmus and his family. And his children. And if I mispronounce any of these names, which I'm very likely to do, if anyone knows the correct pronunciation, I would appreciate the correction. The tale of Cadmus and his daughters is only a prologue to the greater story. It was popular in classical days, and several writers told it in whole or part. I have preferred the account of Apollodorus, who wrote in the 1st or 2nd century AD. He tells it simply and clearly. When Europa was carried away by the bull, her father sent her brothers to search for her, bidding them not to return until they had found her. One of them, Cadmus, instead of looking vaguely here and there, went very sensibly to Delphi to ask Apollo where she was. The god told her not to trouble further about her or his father's determination not to receive him without her, but to found a city of his own. He would come upon a heifer when he left Delphi, Apollo said. He was to follow her and build his city at the spot where she lay down to rest. In this way, Thebes was founded, and the country round about got the name of the heifer's land, Boeotia. First, however, Cadmus had to fight and kill a terrible dragon which guarded a spring nearby and slew all his companions when they went to get water. Alone, he could never have built the city, but when the dragon was dead, Athena appeared to him and told him to sow the earth with the dragon's teeth. He obeyed with no idea what was to happen, and to his terror, saw armed men spring up from the furrows. However, they paid no attention to him, but turned upon each other until all were killed except 5 whom Cadmus induced to become his helpers. With the aid of the 5, Cadmus made Thebes a glorious city and ruled over it in great prosperity and with great wisdom.
They were called Spartans. Spartans.
His Herodotus says that he introduced the alphabet into Greece. His wife was Harmonia, the daughter of Ares and Aphrodite. The gods graced their marriage with their presence, and Aphrodite gave Harmonia a wondrous necklace which had been made by Hephaestus, the workman of Olympus, but which, for all its divine origin, was to bring disaster in a later generation. They had four daughters and one son, and they learned through their children that the wind of the gods' favor never blows steadily for long. All of their daughters were visited by great misfortunes. One of them was Semele, mother of Dionysius, who perished before the unveiled glory of Zeus. Ino was another. She was the wicked stepmother of Phrixus, the boy who was saved from death by the ram of the golden fleece. Her husband was struck with madness and killed their son, Melicertes. With his dead body in her arms, she leaped into the sea. The god saved both them, however. She became a sea goddess, the one who saved Odysseus from drowning when his raft was shattered, and her son became a sea god. In the Odyssey, she is still called Ino, but later her name was changed to Leucothea, and her son was called Palamon. Like her sister Semele, she was fortunate in the end. The two others were not. Both suffered through their sons. Agave was the most wretched of all mothers, driven mad by Dionysius, so that she believed her son Pentheus was a lion and killed him with her own hands. Atone's son was Actaeon, a great hunter. Atone was less wretched than Agave, in that she did not herself kill her son, but she had to endure his dying a terrible death in the strength of his young manhood, a death, too, completely undeserved. He had done no wrong. And it goes on if you would like to hear the rest of it.
No, just how they end it.
Okay.
Is that the ending of their life?
It's not much longer.
Because
that's... He was out hunting, and hot and thirsty entered a grotto where a little stream widened into a pool. He wanted only to cool himself in the crystal water, but all unknowing he had chanced upon a favorite bathing place of Artemis. And at the very moment when the goddess had let fall her garments and stood in her naked beauty on the water's edge, the offended divinity gave not a thought to whether the youth had purposely insulted her or had come there in all innocence. She flung into his face drops from her wet hand, and as they fell upon him, he was changed into a stag. Not only outwardly, his heart became a deer's heart, and he who had never known fear before was afraid and fled. His dog saw him running and chased him. Even his agony of terror could not make him swift enough to outstrip the keen scented pack. They fell upon him, his own faithful hounds, and killed him. Thus great sorrows for their children and grandchildren came upon Cadmus and Harmonia in old age after great prosperity. After Pentheus died, they fled from Thebes, as if trying to flee also from misfortune. But misfortune followed. When they reached far distant Illyria, the gods changed them into serpents. Not as a punishment, for they had done no wrong. Their fate, indeed, was a proof that suffering was not a punishment for wrongdoing. The innocent suffered as often as the guilty. Of all that unfortunate race, no one was more innocent of wrongdoing than Oedipus, the great-great-grandson of Cadmus, and no one suffered so greatly.
Yeah. But would you agree with all of the details? One fact would be clear to all the Thebans. And that is of all the snakes and dragons and serpents, which are the same family. Correct? So, is there a relation? Okay, then we can say Cadmus, snakes, serpents, dragons. What do you say? Be they legendary or not, there's one thing they all do, and that is they lose, or grow a new skin every year. So that there's a cycle. Of changing the outward form and finally perishing. Finally perishing in the last skin they have, right? Mm-hmm. And I don't have to. There are other references to a lyre and harmonia that are not needed Hamilton. So what would really be interesting, if we could get it, would be to ask the question, what would the Greeks at the time of Plato have had in their mind when they heard this myth with this name?
So they were given a lyre by Hermes at their wedding.
Yeah.
For the gods, this was one of the two times in antiquity the gods came to the wedding.
Yeah.
The other was Achilles' father, Theseus. And Hermes gave them a lyre, golden lyre.
That's right. But I didn't hear it in the Hamilton theory.
No.
No, it wasn't much in Albert Graves. No, there is the Albert Graves.
Yeah, right. Good, then I don't have to. So therefore we have the two images, don't we? And that's what we need for the dialogue. So let's jump where we left off, right, and see what we can play with. Okay, who had it? Where did we break it? At that spot, just...
At 92D.
Yeah. Okay, let me pick it up just above it. Let's see. Okay. And yet, said Socrates, there won't be a harmony between it and the theory about harmony above all others, either. That's at 319 in the moment. 92C about. Some readers and we plug forward.
I'll read.
Okay, what? David, you want to play?
Sure.
Yeah.
You have a preference, David?
You want to be talking?
Sure. And yet, there ought to be harmony between it and the theory about harmony above all others.
Yes, there are.
Well, there is no harmony between the two theories. Now, which do you prefer, that knowledge is recollection, or that the soul is a harmony?
The former, decidedly, Socrates. For this other came to me without demonstration, merely seemed probable and attractive, which is the reason why many men hold. I am conscious that those arguments which base their demonstrations on mere probability are deceptive, and if we are not on guard against them, they deceive us greatly in geometry and in all other things. But the theory of recollection and knowledge has been established by a sound course of argument. For we agree that our soul, before it entered into the body, existed just as the very essence, which is called the Absolute, exists. Now I am persuaded that I have accepted the essence on sufficient and right grounds. I cannot therefore accept myself or anyone else the statement that the soul is a harmony. Here's another way of looking at it.
Here's another way of looking at it, Simeon. Do you think a harmony or any other composite thing can be in any other state than that in which the elements are of which it is composed?
Certainly not.
And it can neither do nor suffer anything other than they do or suffer?
Yes.
Then a harmony cannot be expected to leave the elements of which it is composed, but to follow them.
That's true.
A harmony, then, is quite unable to move or make a sound or do anything else that is opposed to its component parts.
Quite unable.
Well, then, is not every harmony by nature a harmony according as it is? As it is harmonized?
I do not understand.
Would it not be more completely a harmony and a greater harmony if there were harmonized, if it were harmonized more fully and to a greater extent, assuming that to be possible, and less completely a harmony and a lesser harmony if less completely harmonized and to a less extent?
Certainly.
Is this true of the soul? Is one soul, even in the slightest degree, more completely and to a greater extent a soul than another, or less completely and to a less extent?
Not in the least.
Well, now, one soul is said to possess sense and virtue and to be good, and another to possess folly and wickedness and to be bad. And is this true?
Yes, it is true.
Now, what will those who assume that the soul is a harmony say that these things, the virtue and the wickedness, are in the soul are? Will they say that this is another kind of harmony and a discord, and that the soul, which is itself a harmony, has within it another harmony, and that the other soul is discordant and has no other harmony within it?
I cannot tell. But evidently, those who make the assumption would say something of that sort.
But we agreed that one soul is no more or less a soul than another, and that is equivalent to an agreement that one is no more and to no greater extent, and no less and to no less extent, a harmony than another, is it not?
Certainly.
And that which is no more and no less a harmony, it's no more or less harmonized, is that so?
Yes.
But has that which is no more and no less harmony harmonized any greater or any less amount of harmony or an equal amount?
An equal amount.
Then a soul, since it is neither more nor less a soul than another, is neither more nor less harmonized.
That is so.
And therefore can have no greater amount of discord or of harmony?
No.
And therefore, again, one soul can have no greater amount of wickedness or virtue than another. If wickedness is discord and virtue harmony.
It cannot.
Or rather, to speak exactly, Simeon, No soul will have any wickedness at all if the soul is a harmony. For if a harmony is entirely harmony, it could have no part in discord.
Certainly not.
Then the soul, being entirely soul, could have no part in wickedness.
How could it if what we have said is right?
According to this argument, then, if all souls are by nature equally souls, all souls of all living creatures will be equally good.
So it seems, Socrates.
And do you think that this is true and that our reasoning would have come to this end if the theory that the soul is a harmony were correct?
Not in the least.
Well, of all the parts that make up a man, do you think any is ruler except the soul, especially if it be a wise one?
No, I do not.
Does it yield to the feelings of the body or oppose them? I mean, when the body is hot and thirsty, does not the soul oppose it and draw it away from drinking and from eating when it is hungry? And do we not see the soul opposing the body in countless other ways?
Certainly.
Did we not agree in our previous discussion that it could never be a harmony to give forth a sound at variance with the tensions and relaxations and vibrations and other conditions of the elements which compose it, but that it would follow them and never leave them?
Yes, we did, of course.
Well then, do we not now find that the soul acts in exactly the opposite way, leading those elements of which it is said to consist, and opposing them in almost everything through all our life, and tyrannizing over them in every way, sometimes inflicting harsh and painful punishments, those of gymnastics and medicine, and sometimes milder ones, sometimes threatening and sometimes admonishing. In short, speaking to the desires and passions and fears as if it were distinct from them, and they from it, as Homer has shown in the Odyssey when he says of Odysseus, "He smote his breast, and thus he chid his heart. Endure it, heart, thou dost bear worse than this." Do you suppose that when he wrote those words, he thought of the soul as a harmony which would be led by the conditions of the body, and not rather as something fitted to lead and rule them, and itself a far more divine thing than a harmony?
By Zeus, Socrates, the latter, I think.
Then, my good friend, it will never do for us to say that the soul is a harmony. For we should, it seems, agree neither with Homer, the divine poet, nor with ourselves.
That is true.
Very well. Harmonia, the Theban goddess has, it seems, been moderately gracious to us. But now, Cebes, and by what argument can we find grace in the sight of Cadmus?
Does that make any sense, that last line? He's dealt with harmonia. He's been moderately gracious.
Can you find grace?
Yeah. And now we have to
go on and
deal with Cadmus.
Mm-hmm.
So, arguments about harmonia are over. And now we'll go to
Cebes and Cadmus. Okay.
And then with Cebes, Cebes stands to Harmonia, as Cebes stands to Cadmus.
We need Cebes.
Up for another round?
Okay.
All right.
I think you will find a way. At any rate, you conducted this argument against harmony wonderfully, and better than I expected. For when Simmias was telling of his difficulty, I wondered if anyone could make head against his argument. So it seemed to me very remarkable that it could not withstand the first attack of your argument. Now I should not be surprised if the argument of Cadmus met with the same fate.
My friend, do not be boastful, lest some evil eye put to rout the argument that is to come. That, however, is in the hands of God. Let us, in Homeric fashion, charge the foe and test the worth of what you say. Now the sum total of what you seek is this. You demand a proof that our soul is indestructible and immortal. If the philosopher, who is confident in the face of death and who thinks that after death he will fare better in the other world than if he had lived his life differently, is not to find his confidence senseless and foolish. And although we show that the soul is strong and godlike and existed before we men were born as men, all this, you say, may bear witness not to immortality, but only to the fact that the soul lasts a long time and existed somewhere, an immeasurably long time before our birth, and knew and did various things, yet it was none the more immortal for all that. But its very entrance into the human body was the beginning of its dissolution, a disease, as it were, and it lives in toil through this life and finally perishes in what we call death. Now it makes no difference, you say, whether a soul enters into a body once or many times, so far as the fear each of us feels is concerned. For anyone, unless he is a fool, must fear, if he does not know and cannot prove that the soul is immortal. That, C.B., is, I think, about what you mean. And I restate it purposely, that nothing may escape us, and that you may, if you wish, add or take away anything.
I do not at present wish to take anything away or add anything. You have expressed my meaning.
So too. Right, so he's playing very tight with that, isn't he? You can tell when someone, say a person is very similar to the snake, and they have they shed their skin 8 times. We don't know exactly how many we have, but sooner or later we wear out our last, and so we perish. Right? So, but you're finally going to be buried in your last garment, your last body, because the soul is worn out. The soul wears out while it wears out the many bodies. Because the soul gets older. It only has a finite number of reincarnations. So he's giving him this, right? He's giving him reincarnation. He's giving him everything he needs. There's only one thing he hasn't. And that is that this line goes on, right, eternally. Now, there's a lot of evidence that this is really a good theory, because a friend of mine made a study of this once, and what he did is to see that there are a lot of people that have more energy than other people. Have you noticed that?
Yeah.
Well, people that have more energy are the people who still have many lifetimes to go. And those that are tired out, those that are, you know, are always tired, wake up tired, go to bed kind of late, very tired, they're working on their last level. So there's empirical evidence for this.
Yeah.
Right?
I'm not too sure of that.
Well, as long as you're not too sure, then we can count that as a victory.
I think it's good, as long as you say it's empirical.
If you use the magic word empirical. Right? So, then the question is, how do you know? How do you know that this might be not, right? How do you know that this one, this life, may not be your last? And therefore you have very good reason to fear death. Louder?
Can't sing it over here.
We're gonna get an old rock and roll song about this may be the last one, but I don't know.
And it's the damnedest thing.
We will expect the words to the music by next Friday. Now, the sum total of what you seek is this. You demand a proof that our soul is indestructible, immortal. If the philosopher is caught in the face of death and thinks that after that he will fare better in the other world, that he had lived his life differently. Trying otherwise to be foolish and senseless to have confidence in the face of death. It may be your last.
Good. You only go around 8 times.
Good.
You only go around once.
Yeah. 1 or 8, you finally face complexity. But before you go, you have to write an essay on what it's going to be like without you.
Yeah.
And if you don't?
Well, you're going to have to come back and do it over.
Oh, okay. That's one way to keep from checking out. Yeah. Oh, I broke my pencil again.
So, what happens is we get Socrates to read that for that prayer. And although we show... Back. That's 95C. And all those show the soul is strong and godlike and existed before. We then look for in his name. All is your soul, may bear witness, not to immortality, but only to the fact that the soul lasts for all of you are. It existed. Somewhere in measurably one time before, it moved in various things, yet it was not a new immortal for all that. Its very entrance into the human body, the beginning of its dissolution, disease, as it were, a life is a disease, a cancer upon the soul that wears itself out through the toil of life. And thus it was living toil through this life. Finally perishes in what we call extinction. There are no physicians of the soul for this plight, and this disease of the soul is spread by reincarnation. Now it makes no difference, you say, whether a soul enters into a body once or many times. As far as the fear, each of us feels his concern for anyone unless he's a fool, must fear. If he does not know or cannot prove that the soul is deathless, that seems as I do think. It's just about what you need. I've stated it purposely. That you can better grasp of you yourself than you're trying to say up this point. You wish you could add to it or take away anything more. Whatever is left, you must carry as a burden, try to grasp it and understand it. See, you said it's time for 6 packs, son. Huh? Well, as I might guess, like, it's just a little bit looser than you.
Forget that hemlock. Send it to your own.
Cedes comes back.
I do not at present wish to take anything away or add anything. You have expressed.
It is no small thing that you seek.
My heart, Socrates paused for some time. It was absorbed in thought. Then he said,
it is no small thing that you seek, for the cause of generation and decay must be completely investigated. Now I will tell you my own experience in the matter, if you wish. Then if anything I say seems to you to be of any use, you can employ it as the solution of your difficulty.
Certainly. I wish to hear your experiences.
Well, is this an argument?
Not so far.
Is it a likelihood?
No.
But do it yourself.
It's a profound shift. Up to this point, you're doing a lot. It's over. It's just over. I'll take out my experience. You can use it. Good. If you can't, so be it.
The do-it-yourself argument?
Yeah. Yeah. If you can employ it for the solution of your difficulties and problems, good. If you can't, so be it.
Listen then, and I will tell you. When I was young, Cebes, I was tremendously eager for the kind of wisdom which they call investigation of nature. I thought it was a glorious thing to know the causes of everything, why each thing comes into being and why it perishes and why it exists. And I was always unsettling myself with such questions as these. Do heat and cold, by a sort of fermentation, bring about the organization of animals, some people say? Is it the blood, or air, or fire by which we think? Or is it none of these? And does the brain furnish the sensation of hearing and sight and smell? And do memory and opinion arise from these? Does knowledge come from memory and opinion in a state of rest? And again, I tried to find out how these things perish. And I investigated the phenomena of heaven and earth until finally, I made up my mind that I was by nature totally unfitted for this kind of investigation. And I will give you a sufficient proof of this. I was so completely blinded by these studies that I lost the knowledge that I had, and others also thought I had before. I forgot what I had formerly believed I knew about many things, and even about the cause of man's growth. For I had thought previously that it was plain to everyone that man grows through eating and drinking. For when from food he eats, flesh is added to his flesh and bones to his bone. And in the same way, the appropriate thing is added to each of his other parts, and then the small bulk becomes greater and the small man large. That is what I used to think. Doesn't that seem to you reasonable?
Yes.
Now listen to this, too. I thought I was sure enough. When I saw a tall man standing by a short one, that he was, say, taller by a head than the other, and that one horse was larger by a head than another horse, and to mention still clearer things than those, I thought 10 were more than 8 because 2 had been added to the 8. And I thought a 2-cubic rule was longer than a 1-cubic rule because it exceeded it by half its length.
And now? What do you think about him?
I am far from thinking that I know the cause of any of these things. I who do not even dare to say when one is added to one, whether the one to which the addition was made has become two, or the one which was added, and the one to which it was added became two by the addition of each of the other. I think it is wonderful that when each of them was separate from the other, each was one, and they were not then two. And when they were brought near each other, this juxtaposition was the cause of their becoming two. And I cannot yet believe that if one is divided, the division causes it to become two. For this is the opposite of the cause which produced two in the former case. For when two arose because one was brought near and added to another one, and now because one is removed and separated from another, I no longer believe that I know by this method even how one is generated, or, in a word, how anything is generated or is I no longer admit this method, but have another confused way of my own. Then one day I heard a man reading from a book, as he said, by
Anaxagoras.
Thank you, Barbara. Then one day I heard a man reading from a book, as he said, by Anaxagoras, that it is the mind that arranges and causes all things. I was pleased with this theory of cause, and it seemed to me to be somehow right that the mind should be the cause of all things. And I thought, if this is so, the mind in arranging things arranges everything and establishes each thing as it is best for it to be. So if anyone wishes to find the cause of the generation or destruction or existence of a particular thing, he must find out what sort of existence or passive state of any kind or activity is best for it. And therefore, in respect to that particular thing and other things too, a man need examine nothing but what is best and most excellent. And then he will necessarily know also what is inferior, since the science of both is the same. As I considered these things, I was delighted to think that I had found in Anaxagoras a teacher of the cause of things quite to my mind. And I thought he would tell me whether the earth is flat or round. And when he had told me that, would go on to explain the cause of the necessity of it, and would tell me the nature of the best and why it is best for the earth to be as it is. And if he said the earth was in the center, he would proceed to show that it is best for it to be in the center. And I had made up my mind that if he made those things clear to me, I would no longer yearn for any other kind of cause. And I had determined that I would find out in the same way about the sun and the moon and the other stars, their relative speed, their revolutions, their other changes, and why the active and passive condition of each of them is for the best. For I never imagined that, when he said they were ordered by intelligence, he would introduce any other cause for these things than that which is best for them to be as they are. So I thought when he assigned the cause of each thing and of all things in common, he would go and explain what is best for each and what is good for all in common. I prized my hopes very highly, and I seized the books very eagerly and read them as fast as I could, that I might know as fast as I could about the best and the worst. My glorious hope, my friend, was quickly snatched away from me. As I went on with my reading, I saw that the man made no use of intelligence. He did not assign any real causes for the ordering of things, but mentioned as causes air and ether and water and many other absurdities. And it seemed to me it was very much as if one should say that Socrates does with intelligence whatever he does, and then, in trying to give the causes of a particular thing I do, should say first that I am now sitting here because my body is composed of bones and sinews. And the bones are hard and have joints which divide them, and the sinews can be contracted and relaxed. And with the flesh and the skin which contain them all are laid about the bones. And so, as the bones are hung loose in their ligaments, the sinews, by relaxing and contracting, make me able to bend my limbs now, and that is the cause of my sitting here with my legs bent. Or as if in the same way he should give voice and air and hearing and countless other things of the sort as causes for our talking with each other, and should fail to mention the real causes, which are, that the Athenians decided, that it was best to condemn me, and therefore I have decided that it was best for me to sit here, and that it is right for me to stay and undergo whatever penalty they order. For by the dog, I fancy these bones and sinews of mine would have been in Megara on Boeotia long ago, carried thither by an opinion of what was best. If I did not think it was better and nobler to endure any penalty the city might may inflict rather than to escape and run away. But it is most absurd to call things of that sort causes. If anyone were to say that I could not have done what I thought proper, if I had not bones and sinews and other things that I have, he would be right. But to say that those things are the cause of my doing what I do, that I act with intelligence, but not from the choice of what is best, would be an extremely careless way of talking. Whoever talks in that way is unable to make a distinction and to see that in reality that a cause is one thing, and the thing without which the cause could never be a cause is quite another thing. So it seems to me that most people, when they give the name of cause to the latter, are groping in the dark, as it were, and are giving it a name that does not belong to it. And so one man makes the earth stay below the heavens by putting a vortex about it. Another regards the earth as a flat frog ported on the foundation of air. But they do not look for the power which causes things to be now placed as it is best for them to be placed. Nor do they think it has any divine force, but they think they can find a new Atlas, more powerful and more immortal and more all-embracing than this. And in truth, they give no thought to the good, which must embrace and hold together all things. Now, I would gladly be the pupil of anyone who would teach me the nature of such a cause. But since that was denied me, and I was not able to discover it myself or to learn of it from anyone else, do you wish me, Cebes, to give you an account of the way in which I have conducted my second voyage in quest of the cause?
I wish it with all my heart.
After this, then. Okay.
Break it there. That's what we have. We have what we need. Take a look at the first voyage. He had a certain expectation for that Anaxagoras. If he put that down on the board, he was disillusioned. He proceeded on his own. Did he fulfill it? That's real assured for us. We have that exact.
Cecil was not able to discover it himself or learn from anyone else.
Yep. See, mind arranges and causes all things. That's the basic teaching. Would you agree with that? And so, then he tells how he wants to understand, how he understands that. And I believe that's at 97D. The way to do this, what this theory requires, is that one must discover what is best and most excellent for each thing. way the opposite. Right, and the inferior thing is the opposite. Right, would you agree that he doesn't find that in Exodus? I never imagined that when they said they were ordered by intelligence, he would introduce any other cause for these things than that it is best for them to be as they are. Right. So, this is the key, isn't it? That's what he expects to follow. Good heavens, I was discovering that they never even did that. They started going into different kinds of causes, so-called elements or principles. I went on to my reading and I saw that the man named Williams of intelligence did not assign any real causes to the ordering of things. So it was a failure. I didn't see any causes. I didn't discover any real causes. Right, I found no causes. I'm paraphrasing that section. And what he does do is he has a reduction theory. Rather, they reduce explanations to things, to forces, principles, elements. Very disillusioned, agree? Now, there's a shift at the bottom of the page. As I say, it's very much like if someone to look at my present life and would say, hey, it's the material things that cause me to be where I am. It's like saying, my legs and my muscles are the reason why I'm in jail, sitting here. That's the reason. Physical things. Because I walked
through the door.
Yeah. Or as if in the same way he should give voice and air and hearing and countless other things of the sort as causes for our talking with each other, and should fail to mention the real causes. Which are the Athenians decided that it was best. Right? Yes. These are the real causes. Right? This is Socrates' real causes, isn't it? Which is an explanation of why I am here facing death. What? Right? The Athenians? Right, they judged it. Right, they said, hey, you know what? It's best to condemn it. Now that's a real cause. And therefore, I decided that it was best for me to sit here. Right? Best. And that it's right for me to stay and undergo whatever penalty they have to order. Right? Right? It's best for me to sit it, and it's right for me to stay and take whatever consequences follow, right? And it's right to accept the consequences. Right, is that what he said? Look here. What has he done? We can go a little further. Is he picking up with Anaxagoras' failure? Well, there's a basic difference, isn't there? Right? Basic difference. But to say that those things are the cause of my doing what I do, and that I act with intelligence, but not from the choice of what is best, would be an extremely frivolous way of talking. Where he talks in that way is unable to make a distinction. Right? And here's where he pulls it together. See that in reality, the cause is one thing, and the thing without which the cause cannot be a cause is quite another thing. So this is his condition for what causes. Most people use the word cause as just groping in the dark. They don't know what they're talking about. And therefore, we're really going to have to look at this carefully, right? That definition. In that way is unable to make a distinction. See that in reality, a cause is one thing, and the thing without which the cause can never be a cause is quite another thing. A cause is one thing, but that without which the cause can never be a cause, that's quite another. Quite a load.
So the cause of the cause, right?
Huh?
The cause of the cause?
The condition for the cause.
Condition.
That
without which it can't be a cause.
It's condition.
The ground. Condition for the operation.
Yeah. Yeah. The condition for the ground.
If he's in jail because he thinks best, thinking best is the cause of his being there. That without which the cause could not be a cause is the body that walked in the door.
Is what?
Is the body that walked in the door. That without which it could not be a cause, it couldn't cause him to be there. That's how I understand it.
Yeah, that's one way of going. That's one way of going.
The idea that it's best for him to be there wouldn't get him in the jail cell unless he could walk in there or if he carried him.
Yeah, could go both ways. Why don't you read for Lyra? So one man makes the earth stay below the heavens by putting a vortex above it. Another regards the earth as a flat trough supported on a foundation of air. But they do not look for the power which causes things to be placed as it is best for them. What don't they do? Right? What don't they do?
Look for what is best.
They fail in some basic way. What do they fail?
Look for the cause that would be best for
them. Read it for me. What do they fail to do?
The that they do not look to the power of
right.
the cause.
Right. Right. What did I hear? What else did I hear from?
Power.
Yeah. Go ahead. Keep reading.
Which causes things to be now placed as it is best for them to be.
Yeah. What's the power do? What's it do? This power does something. How does it function?
It causes things to be placed as it is best for them to be placed. Placed in jail.
Right, there's a power. What did it do?
Placed in the
jail. Right? Okay, but they do not look for the power which causes things to be placed as it's best for them to be placed. Right? Now, what else does he say about it? Right? What else does he say about it?
Nor do they think that it has any divine force.
So what will we do? We'll say that power has to be what?
Divine.
Right. Keep going.
But they think they can find a new atlas more powerful and more immortal and more all-embracing than this. And in truth, they give no thought to the good.
Right. Which?
Which must embrace and hold together all and all.
Good. It embraces. Right. Right, it includes everything, doesn't it? Right, it embraces and holds together all things. Not just holds together all things. Right, it should be. In the idea of embraces, it's a positive. Right, because embraces ought to be positive. Because it's best. Best, positive. Well, these are all positive qualities. Right? 4, 5, 6, 7. Right? So there is a physical side, right? But there's also the condition for a cause to be a cause. What's the condition? The ground. That there is this power or divine force that embraces and holds together all things in the way in which it is best for them to be held. Right? And there's a difference between this and Anaxagoras. But let's hold that for a little bit. Now, we have to look at the next sentence. Right? Now, I would gladly be the pupil of anyone who would teach me the nature of such a cause. Where does that go? What's the antecedent? Right? I'll jump ahead and say, take your sides, right? Argue well, because the consequences as you finish that sentence are rather large. All right, what are the possibilities? You can go back to the atlas, the new atlas, can it not? You can go back to what we just been describing. How did it decide? Because look what caused. Right? But since that was denied me, I was not able to discover it myself or to learn it through anyone else, do you wish me to give you the second account, my second voyage? Where does it go? And why? Barbara, how's it look to you?
How's all the damage?
I'd like to work on the back of the sacred work, as well as in truth, they give no thought to the good, which must embrace and hold together all things. Mm-hmm. Right? And third, where does that reference go, which we just mentioned? Right?
What reference are you referring to? I need that part.
Yeah.
I was reading.
Yeah, well, at the bottom of the page. Now I'm glad that these people are anyone who teach you the nature of such a cause. Where does the such a cause go? Precede exception.
Go back to that causes things to be placed, that which causes things to be placed, that's the best for me to place.
Okay, then it would be this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then what he doesn't know about, he's never learned anything about, is this thing that he's just described.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's one possibility. You'd have a reason for it, I presume. Carson, please. We can check other translations, of course.
No.
That would be up.
No, beyond that. He says they think they can find a cause more powerful than that.
Yeah, that's right.
Right. Nobody's ever taught him a cause more powerful than the good.
A new, more powerful atlas.
Yeah, he never learned about that.
Right? Right? Yeah. If that's the case, then, right?
Mm-hmm.
What does that do to the conclusion?
It's not. It's not so devastating.
It's not so devastating.
We still may be dealing with Sakyamuni.
Yeah. Well, we will wait and hear while I indulge myself in a freshman plan. You sure are a feminine cat, too. Looks like a little lady, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
She said, well, you can sport a fur coat like mine.
One of the
fine, Barbara, how does it look for you? Sarah, how'd it go? Go along with us, reason it? Gina, Paul?
Power could be the good that he was talking about, which was to grace and hold the good of all things.
Yeah, okay. How about the question of?
Which would be then, when he's saying, teach me the nature of such a cause, he would be talking about doing the good, which is then the power.
And that's what he doesn't know.
That's how I could see he could do it.
Yeah.
One way.
How would it be decided? By what kind of question? What kind of, you know, let's say we all made our votes. Okay, now what principle of the selective choice you're talking?
Well, there always has to be a condition, right, for the cause. So if the good itself was a cause, it would have to have a condition. So it seemed to me the good would be a condition. Something else would be a cause.
Yeah, that's, I think, pretty good. Now I would gladly be the pupil of anyone who would teach me the nature of such a cause. Now, doesn't that presuppose that we're talking about something in the preceding sentence?
Okay. Well, if there's someone that can...
Well, are there a number of views he enumerates about there?
Mm-hmm.
And so one man makes the earth, so another regards the earth, right? Then they don't do certain things, but that's not essential, right, for the parent, for the sentence. Right? But they do think, right, they found a new atlas more powerful and more all-embracing than this.
So they think they can find it.
Right? And in saying that, he also has, but they don't do this and they don't do that.
They.
Yeah. Right, these people, they. And then they're brought together. They think they can find a new atlas, more powerful, more all embracing than this.
So they're all looking for something else.
Yeah. So, hey, you know what? That's the cause they're looking for.
Mm-hmm.
You know the nature of that cause? Sure be glad if people of anyone would teach me the nature of such a cause. Now, in that, there's a lot of things that they don't do.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Mm-hmm. Now, Barbara, what principle would you use to say why you have to go for the one and not the other? That's why I agree with that. For me, he's saying they do this and they do this. And now, by the way, they kind of come together and look at this. They don't do this, they don't do this, they don't do this. Oh, by the way, if somebody could teach me such a cause.
Are they able to make a distinction? The cause that they're seeking. Is that what you're looking at?
Yeah.
Seems like he's saying that they're looking beyond this cause, the cause that he's pointing at, right? That they are looking for the act, which is just the same point that's being made, but it seems like the point of the sentence is that they think they can find the new atlas more powerful, more immortal, more all-embracing than this. Since he's got this and they're looking for the beyond. And that's the way that sentence is structured. Mm-hmm. So when he says, such a cause would have to refer not to the one he has in hand, but to that one that's transcendent to it.
Yeah,
is that fair? Why? I agree with you. Yeah, that's the same thing, right. That's why I don't understand your question. Right. So you don't think that's that qualifies as a
principle? Well, I guess I'd ad hoc a principle. You know, say when there's a principal subject, the author's making exceptions. It's the principal subject that a reference would be made, proper reference would be made, and not to the exceptions. Hmm. But I don't know how that would stand up in Brooklyn.
They're tough in Brooklyn. That's a great argument. Principal reference exception.
Fine, you know, I'm hot on that one. That's my car.
Could this be compared to, like, parts to a whole? They're looking at the parts, and the whole would be the unity looking at them.
Yeah, in this sentence, I think Barber, Ray Barber's pushing it, the way Rod was moving it. They're going for a far greater all-embracing whole than what I have. And someone could teach me about that all-embracing greater one, I'm glad to make. A student of that, someone can teach me about it. I try and those things or something.
Just they can't tell a cause from an effect.
Yeah. What are their problems if they can't tell a cause from an
effect? But they're going to try to go beyond whatever means.
Yeah, they're going to try to go for it. They're going to try to go for the condition for a cause to be a cause before they understand what a cause is. Mm-hmm. You say, hey, you know me? I know what a real cause is, therefore I can do this. That for the sake of which, you know, that's the definition of Aristotle's fourth clause. That's where he gets it. That's it, you know, the teleological clause. That, the total end, the total end. I'll tell you what I find interesting about this. But first, let me ask you people who like the Greek. What do you do with that expression, truth, I give no thought for the good, to the good, which must embrace and hold together all things? And after this word, things. Absolutely essential. All right? Otherwise, I'm not going to give you my theory. So I had to knock that out first. Right? Or at least put it in doubt. It's just embrace and holds together all. Mm-hmm. Okay. You see? See the difference? Now we go back here. mind arranges and causes all things. Back there, please. There you have.
Tantalum could be hubal.
That's right, hubal. Tantalum, the cause, atios.
Mm-hmm. And the arranging is diocosma. Diocosma. Of course, our lips is in the whole. Diocosma, take on a pot going to.
See, if we do this. All right, kind of do this for a moment. All right, we're putting this in question. We're putting this in question. Because when Anaxagoras had this, he then went to explain it, explain causes in terms of phenomena. He went to the background material causes or forces. Socrates doesn't go there. He only goes for rational causes. That's the only place he's going. Mind, right, arranges and causes, right, arranges and causes of all. Embraces, holds together all. Fine. His example, though, doesn't embrace the muscles and the bones. It's the mind. It's the mind. And the decisions that he made. It's the decisions that he made. Under the impact of a power and divine force, which we all know we spoke of. That's the real cause for the physical. That determines the physical. So if you want to get to causes for him, right, you have to get into mind. Therefore, the only proper way in which you can explore causes is in the mind. Therefore, only into human behavior. Unless you want to get into the mind of all things, then you can perhaps do it too. In any case, that's the only way you can do it. Because otherwise, you'd have to make sure that the way things are physically are there because they're best. How can you figure that out? You can do it here. People, me, so I produce that, should be other me, other, the other person. It's like a discussion I had at the college the other day. One of the guys in the science lab is saying all the paradoxes of science demonstrate that reason is incapable of grasping the nature of things. I said, of course not. Its primary purpose wasn't designed to go around and measure garbage cans. Primary purpose of the mind was to explore one another. That's for people. That's where language reaches its finest product, right? As a communication tool among people. Not picking up rocks. Right? So it doesn't understand the physical universe as best as it can, because language may not be primarily serving that purpose. But in terms of mind and philosophy, it's the most perfect tool you can do. We've been doing it for years. A friend of mine was doing it for philosophy. He was in it for about 8 years. You know that? Yeah, all right, you don't believe
me. You know
me.
What?
Yes, I would love to hear that.
Just, I was looking at that question on what the difference is between the Greek, between the Anaxagoras and Socrates. If you look four lines up on 340.
On 340?
Page 340, yeah.
Quarter.
It's
340. Yeah.
99C at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
It's real interesting because the first time he talks about it, more all-embracing, he uses only, he uses five lines up. Right? Apanta, hapanta, sunekanta, suneko, holding together, all. But at the bottom, when he talks about what Socrates giving his own opinion, he's talking about hos alethos to agathon kai deon sundeon kai sunekhin uden oyantai, which goes as truthfully the good and it's necessary binding together. See sundeon? Binding together and holding together, and there's no object in that. You know, there's no all things. There's no all.
It's even better.
Yeah.
Binding together and holding together.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You could do nicely with a translation. So how would you do that for the whole thing? Make any other changes?
Let's see. It's truthfully the good necessarily binds together and holds together. They think nothing is the last two words. They think nothing in truth or truthfully. Truthfully, they think nothing about the fact that you have to. The good necessarily binds together and holds together. There's no object. So I can't do anything more with translation at this point than I can see. It just seems to be lacking, but that's my perception. There's no, that there's no object kind of leaves me hanging on. You know. But I like it better that it's not. That there's no object.
Could you do that one more time, Barbara? From 240 day or?
Yeah. Indeed. So truthfully, they think nothing.
We done?
Well, I'm trying to see how that would fit in English. As truthfully, they do not think that the good must necessarily bind together and hold together, both bind together and hold together. So you might say they have no thought for the function of the good as binding together and holding together.
So because that's what this is to. This is the image he's using.
Mm-hmm.
That rational force binds together, holds together.
Mm-hmm.
What he's doing, mm-hmm. is it's best for himself, it's best for himself.
And it's rather like it doesn't even dawn on these idiots, or it doesn't even dawn on these people that they have no thought about it, that the good, it's the good that binds and holds.
Well, I certainly enjoyed that. When? 9:30?
Bing!
What's that?
9:33.
We worked overtime.
That was Barbara's point, holding us up to the point. Right?
So we're ready for the second voyage?
Yeah.
All right.
Just one question?
Please.
Because you said the question about the translation, and then somehow I missed Anaxagoras' part. I got how you were distinguishing Socrates, but I didn't.
Well, you see, he starts out nobly. He starts out nobly. There isn't any difference.
Uh-huh.
As I say, uh-huh. I don't know about the Greek. I don't think that's it. But then he descends into particular forces, elements or principles, and gives up them.
Gives up.
Starts out noble and then gives up. Can't maintain it.
Can't support it or maintain it. No demonstration.
I was really excited by her now. Well, that's what you really wanted.
It's when you go and buy the book. It's a good review and then...
But then when he talks about real causes, he's going back to the idea of mind. Is that...
I don't know. What do you think?
Well, it seems like it.
Oh, okay. But what?
Is that what was being said about real causes?
Well, I don't know.
Yeah.
What?
That he's going back to the idea of using mind.
Well, tell me, what's the first one?
Athenian thought it best to condemn him.
What kind of a thing is that?
It was a rational decision.
Right, yeah. Second?
Best for me to sit here.
Right, if he considers everything.
Right.
What's that?
Rational decision, and right to accept. So he's going back. So those are the real causes, is when you return and arrange things through the mind. Which is
anorexia.
Position in Deva. That's how I'm understanding it, that was being said.
Yes and no. I don't know what you mean. I'm saying that this is a statement that promises something, but he doesn't deliver, does he?
No.
Is that right? And Socrates picks it up and continues it, but not for physical things, the sun, the moon, the stars, does he? But for rational behavior. Ready to get a cup?
Mm-hmm. I have a question about that one that says that without which the cause could not be a cause.
Iran. Okay.
Is he talking about essence?
Sure would be nice, wouldn't it? For that to be an essence, and who see it? He does mention who see it. Let's see.
Yeah.
Look that.
That's that terrible translation.
Yeah.
Pericles learned mind and not mind something from the Phaedrus. And that's the same Pericles who wasn't able to make anybody wise in the Alcibiades.
Whether or not you can relate that to his idea of cause.
Mm-hmm.
as much as you can get appears to be the good itself, right? The good. But in the second one we're playing with, I don't see any of C.
No, the first one that comes up is on 101C4 after that.
Yeah. Well, thank goodness we have a week to it.